subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. Nearly 3 weeks after a violent clash between the Indian and the Chinese soldiers at Galwan patrolling point in Ladakh, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi paid a surprise visit to the Indian troops in the region. He hailed the valor of Indian troops and made an indirect assertion on the expansionist designs of China. India has upped its assertiveness along the border ever since China tried to intrude in its territory.
In a surprise visit to the troops in Ladakh, the region home to multiple flashpoints between India and China, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi asserted that times of expansionisms were over and the world needed to look beyond such ambitions. In an indirect reference of China, Modi said that history was witness of the fact that those who tried gaining control of others' territories were badly defeated.
पूरे विश्व ने विस्तारवाद के खिलाफ मन बना लिया है। आज विश्व विकासवाद को समर्पित है। और विकास की खुली स्पर्धा का स्वागत कर रहा है।
PM Modi also hailed the courage of Indian troops, who he said had given a befitting response to those who had tried making illegal intrusions into Indian territory.
अब देश में बॉर्डर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पर खर्च करीब-करीब 3 गुना कर दिया गया है। इससे बॉर्डर एरिया डेवलपमेंट और सीमा पर सड़कें पुल बनाने का काम भी बहुत तेजी से हुआ है।
Seemingly, New Delhi has decided to give it back to China, which is accused of bullying other countries. From Taiwan to Japan to Australia, everybody has called accused Beijing of interfering in its issues. While it has continued with its infrastructure building in its sovereign territory on one side, it also took a host of decisions affecting Beijing. Earlier, the government had banned 59 Chinese apps, which it said were posing threats to the security and sovereignty of India.
The world's largest software and internet application companies are present in India. Naturally, while operating in India, they have to abide by our rules and regulations issued by the relevant ministries and departments, including those pertaining to data security and privacy of individual data.
India was TikTok's top growth market and made up to 30% of its $2 billion download worldwide. If China has been stealing data through these apps, then it certainly posed a major security threat to Indian security. The Chinese apps have recorded around 4.9 billion downloads in India since January 2014.
Moving on, Baloch held anti-Pakistan protests in Quetta and European towns to mark the abduction anniversary of Dr. Deen Mohammed and urged the United Nations to intervene in the grave issue of mass abductions being carried out by Pakistan establishment on everyday basis. Pakistan has exploited resource-rich Balochistan to cater influential Punjabi people and have not shared any dividends with locals. Many of them protested against this injustice. As a result, the state launched a systematic crackdown against Baloch, which has now converted into ethnic cleansing of these people.
This group of men expressing anger against the UNO for not providing any support to oppressed Balochs is Berlin-based Baloch National Movement, a party striving for Baloch rights and their freedom from the clutches of Pakistan.
Freedom! Freedom! Freedom!
A number of its members gathered in Germany's capital, sloganeered against Pakistan and demanded freedom to mark the 11th abduction anniversary of Dr. Deen Muhammad, a renowned Baloch freedom fighter who was abducted with no trace from his neighborhood in 2009. His family has since then been looking for him, but they have not received any success. Baloch say that there have been hundreds of other similar cases in Balochistan in which the activists were held incommunicado for years, tortured and even murdered. They fear Deen Muhammad also met a similar fate.
Since his abduction, his whereabouts is still remain unknown. His family has been striving for his safe recovery from past 11 years. Sami and Mehlab, daughter of Dr. Deen Muhammad Baloch, have been struggling for release of their father and have knocked the door of every court in Pakistan. They even organized dozens of protests, press conferences, held hunger strike camps, and they held a 3,000-kilometer long march from Quetta to Islamabad, alone with other victims' family, but failed to get justice from Pakistani institutions and human rights organizations.
Similar protests to commemorate his abduction were held in Balochistan's capital Quetta too, where the family members of a number of Balochs who have been abducted or killed by Pak army gathered. While they urged Pakistani army to leave their land, it was the state-sponsored ethnic cleansing of Balochs by Pakistan which remained the prime focus during protest. Baloch said that Pakistan had increased the number of crackdowns on Balochs several fold in the recent times, and not even a day in Balochistan passed without news of Pakistan's barbarity. The number of Pakistani atrocities Balochs have revealed are horrifying. More than 53,000 people have been abducted from Balochistan. This includes 350 women and 200 innocent children. Deemed as the backbone of society, the Baloch youths have been targeted with impunity. As many as 18,000 lost their lives for raising their head against Pakistani barbarism. A number of Baloch activists have accused China in the past for increased violence in the region. They say Pakistani army is just paving way for the China-Pakistan economic corridor, which the Balochs have opposed vehemently. Pakistan has taken billions of dollars in loans from Beijing and is obliged to do what the latter demands. Its leaders, they say, will get a share in CPEC profits, but the quality of Baloch life will deteriorate further. Baloch say a region where poverty is already widespread due to state policies cannot even expect its future when both China and Pakistan will plunder it together.
Moving on. As the number of coronavirus cases are witnessing a sharp rise in India, the government has stepped up its fight. The authorities have been working round the clock to organize more facilities for both who have contracted the virus and those who are vulnerable. And it is due to these sustained efforts that they were in position to lift some more restrictions in country's second round of unlock, a phased transition from lockdown to normalcy.
The malls in the satellite cities of Indian capital New Delhi opened as the federal government eased restrictions on public places during the second phase of the reopening of month-long lockdown. The move came in the lines of Indian government slowly restarting economic activities in a bid to get the economy back up after the lockdown imposed in March left millions without work. People visiting the malls are adhering to the set of guidelines issued by the government so that a further surge of infections could be prevented. Security staff won't allow anyone without essential protectives.
Face mask har aadmi ke upar aur hand gloves har aadmi ke paas PPT kit issue hoga wo bhi individual aadmi ka jo bhi proper checking hogi aur jo bhi customer aate hain unka social distancing ka checking karne ka taur tareeke se as per SOP.
With one of the lowest fatality rates across the world, India, with the population of nearly 1.35 billion, has around 630,000 cases, out of which around 379,000 have recovered. Unlike the decisions many European and American countries took, which subsequently doomed, Indian government decided to put in strict restrictions at early stages and saved itself from getting overwhelmed with infected numbers. Integrated efforts of the state and federal government with an overwhelming public support have put India ahead of many developed countries in fight against the coronavirus. Today, the positive cases per million in India stand at 357 against global average of 1,250, while Indian mortality rate is 11 against the global numbers of 63.2, its recovery rate has been 57. The government says it has been relentless and has been ramping up all facilities across the country.
June तक हमने 30,000 बेड बन जाएंगे. रेलवे कोचेस के अंदर 8,000 बेड बने और 8,000 की तैयारी है. मगर मैं अभी 8,000 ही गिन रहा हूँ. DRDO एक एक्सक्लूसिव कोविड अस्पताल बना रही है जिसमें 250 ICU बेड भी होंगे विथ वेंटिलेटर होंगे. वो अलग से बने हैं और 10,000 का ITBP संचालित राधास्वामी सत्संग न्यास के बड़े कैंपस के अंदर बारिश की सीजन को ध्यान में रखकर हमने बेड बनाए हैं. इसको ITBP संचालित कर.
Meanwhile, Prime Minister Narendra Modi extended the poor welfare campaign by 5 more months. This will ensure free food grains to 800 million people till November. PM Modi said that the government will keep providing free food grains to the poor section of the society due to the increased need during the festivals.
Moving on, In a remarkable development from Afghanistan, which has raked up a storm in the alleys of White House and has potentially thrown a spanner in US President Donald Trump's works of repatriating all US soldiers from the war-torn region. The Russian military, as per the intelligence reports, paid cash rewards to Taliban for attacking US personnel. While both the White House and the Kremlin have rubbished the reports, the Democrats have sought an action against Russia for conspiring against US soldiers.
This piece of report carried out by a US daily, New York Times, has all the potential of derailing the US arrangements and the successes it has secured in the protracted war of Afghanistan. As revealed in the report, Russian military reaching out to Taliban and demanding attack on US troops and their allies might trigger a change in the plans of the US, which signed a deal with Taliban in February to exit in a phased manner. While many international observers feel that President's prominence and authority has been disregarded in this case, the White House has not confirmed the veracity of the reports.
I won't speculate on whether this intelligence is verified or not verified, and I won't get ahead of the president on further actions, but I would just point out that there are dissenting opinions within the intelligence community, and I can confirm with you right now that there is no consensus within the intelligence community on these allegations. And further, I would just point out, I won't get ahead of the president on actions, but with regard to Russia, this president has been extremely strong on Russia, imposing sanctions on hundreds of Russian individuals, expelling dozens of diplomats, closing two Russian consulates, withdrawing from an INF treaty, and several other actions.
In 2019, the US forces lost 20 troops while fighting Taliban. But with fresh revelations, it remains to be seen as to how many were targeted allegedly at the behest of Moscow. The recent developments have triggered a multi-layered debate in the States, with Democrats criticizing the president and seeking harsh measures against Moscow. The Secretary of State says such reports were taken and retracted with all seriousness by Washington, as everybody knew that Russia was constantly hatching anti-US plots in Afghanistan.
We took this seriously. We handled it appropriately. The Russians have been selling small arms that put Americans at risk there for 10 years. We've objected to it. To your point, when I meet with my Russian counterparts, I talk with them about this each time. Stop this.
The ties between the United States and Russia have deteriorated significantly over time. While the Kremlin has outrightly rejected the allegations, it cannot be denied that the two sides have for decades been trying to outmaneuver each other through their intelligence gains and sabotage the operations. As per various reports, Russia has already been running clandestine operations in Afghanistan. Its interest in the negotiations with Taliban also became apparent when it hosted Taliban and other non-governmental influential leaders in Moscow.
Moving on. Pakistan has been for years exploiting its illegally occupied regions of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK. It has not just plundered the resources of the region itself, but has also given a free hand to its ally China for doing the same. Both of them together have created havoc in the lives of the people in these occupied territories. And now, as India is busy dealing with China after the dispute at Ladakh's Galwan Valley, Pakistan, seeing the opportunity, is now trying to move ahead with its devious agenda. We have a report.
In the last 70 decades, Pakistan has left no stone unturned in making the lives of the people of its illegally occupied territories a living hell. Be it suppressing their voices, denying their rights, or exploiting the resources that only belong to them, Pakistan has always imposed a colonial treatment on the people of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK. Adding more to the woes of these beleaguered people, Pakistan even allowed its ally China to plunder the natural resources in the regions by encompassing a plethora of construction and developmental projects. India, on a number of occasions, has shown its concern about the resource exploitation and has even asked Pakistan to immediately vacate the illegally occupied territories of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK. But Pakistan doesn't seem to stop with its nefarious activities, and now with India and China entering into a border dispute, Pakistan has got a golden opportunity to gain stronghold over the illegally occupied territories. And as a result, it has again proposed amendment in the POK Interim Constitution Act 1974, whose main motive is to suppress the voices raised against the misrule of Pakistani government.
चाइना की बढ़ती हुई इन्वॉल्वमेंट है, तो उसमें पाकिस्तान ने उसको फ्री हैंड दिया हुआ है। और पाकिस्तान के जो डिफेंस के एनालिस्ट करने वाले हैं, एनालिसिस करते हैं टीवी टॉक शोज में बैठ के, वो बड़े हैप्पी हैं कि जी चाइना ने एंगेज कर लिया है इंडिया को लद्दाख में, और अब हमें कोई नहीं पूछेगा गिलगित बल्तिस्तान में, पीओके में हम जो कुछ करते रहे। और इसी वजह से वो एक्ट 1974 जो है उसमें नई अमेंडमेंट्स ला रहे हैं। पहले तो ये था कि जो प्रो कश्मीर थे, प्रो इंडिपेंडेंस पे बिलीव रखने वाले लोग थे, जो स्टेट ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर का एक्सेशन नहीं चाहते थे पाकिस्तान के साथ, तो उनको इलेक्शंस में या गवर्नमेंट जॉब्स में उनको कोई शेयर नहीं दिया जाता था, अलाउ नहीं किया जाता था। लेकिन अब वो ये चाहते हैं कि जो भी वाइस है, जो अपने नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज के हवाले से, अपनी आइडेंटिटी के हवाले से, अपने लोगों के हकूक के हवाले से आवाज रेज कर रहे हैं, तो उनको इन द नेम ऑफ the sovereignty of Pakistan, integrity of Pakistan, सबको बैन किया जाए।
Pakistan has not just been committing atrocities on the people of illegally occupied territories, but even those living in other provinces like Sindh and Balochistan are also meted out with the same treatment if they demand for their rights or raise their voices against Pakistani authorities. Moreover, it's quite ironic that on one hand, Pakistani government neglects Gilgit-Baltistan and POK on the grounds of being disputed areas, but on the other, it is looting all their natural resources.
जो भी अपने rights की बात करता है, चाहे वो सिंधी है, बलोच है, पश्तून है, POK से है, Gilgit-Baltistan से है उसका ताल्लुक, तो वो state victim है। और एक पॉलिसी के तहत जितनी भी सेन वाइसेस हैं, जो प्रो पीपल हैं, जो प्रो पीस हैं, तो उनको टारगेट किया जाता है। और जो एक्सट्रीमिस्ट ग्रुप हैं, जो पूरी स्टेट के अंदर फ्रीली रूमिंग कर रहे हैं, उनको फ्री एंड है। और पाकिस्तान का जो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन है, तो वो क्लियरली कहता है कि स्टेट ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर, इंटायर स्टेट ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर इंक्लूडिंग पीओके, गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान डिस्प्यूटेड है। लेकिन जब उसकी नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज की प्लंडरिंग की बात आती है, तो वो बड़े हैप्पीली जो है ना वहां जाके प्लंडर भी करते हैं, लोगों को राइट्स भी नहीं देते। और जो अपने राइट्स के लिए अगर अपनी कोई वॉइस रेज करते हैं पीसफुली, तो उनको भी अब वो बैन करना चाहते हैं, ताकि कोई ऐसी वॉइस उस रीजन से आई ना।
पाकिस्तान हैज फॉर इयर्स not just exploited the people and the resources of its illegally occupied territories, but has also pushed them to a state of complete oblivion with its corrupt practices.
Pakistani designs have always been foiled by both Kashmiri people and Indian support they get. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.